pneumatic retinopexy is a minimally invasive and non-incisional procedure for repairing retinal detachment in selected clinical cases. It consists of injecting an expendable gas and applying retinal cryotherapy or laser photocoagulation to seal retinal breaks. This procedure is associated with reduced morbidity, reduced cost, and faster postoperative recovery compared to pars plana vitrectomy and scleral buckling. In this picture, we can see the intraocular gas bubble and retinal scars from cryopexy. The technique of repairing retinal detachment by retinopexy followed by gas endotamponade was first described by Rosengreen in 1938. However, this method was not widely practiced until after the publication of Hilton and Grisard's paper in 1986, in which they describe what we recognize as a modern pneumatic retinopexy. The recommended surgical technique begins with a clinical examination and identification of retinal breaks, retinal re-examination with confirmation of all areas of pathology is very important. The eye is anesthetized with topical proximetacaine, and subtenon or subconjunctival injection of 2% lidocaine. If necessary, a retrobulbar block can also be performed, but this would affect the patient's ability to cooperate in moving the eyes in the direction necessary to treat retinal tears. Visualize retinal breaks with the binocular indirect ophthalmoscope. Apply transscleral cryopexy to the retinal breaks. Care should be taken to avoid excess cryotherapy to prevent possible release of retinal pigment epithelium cells and subsequent proliferative vitreoretinopathy formation. Laser photocoagulation can be used in attached areas of retina. Pseudophakic and high-risk eyes might benefit from 360-degree laser. Alternative option is to do a staged procedure. First, inject gas. Have a patient position with bubble on the tear to flatten the retina, and then perform laser to the retinal tear a few days after the retina is flat. Intraocular gas. You can use SF6 or C3F8. SF6 will expand 2 times and lasts for 1 to 2 weeks. Volume of gas injected 0.5 to 0.6 cc. C3F8 will expand 4 times and last for 4 to 8 weeks. Volume of gas injected 0.3 cc. Use the smallest bubble needed to cover the pathology, keeping in mind that the gas volume needed to cover the given arc of retina will increase with myopia. Pre-fill the system to remove dead space before drawing up the amount of gas to be injected, and attaching a 30-gauge needle. Anterior chamber paracentesis. 27 or 30-gauge needle attached to a tuberculin syringe is used to enter in the anterior chamber at the limbus. 0.2 to 0.4 cc of fluid is usually withdrawn from the anterior chamber. Intraocular gas injection. through an entry site in a quadrant away from the detachment. Enter the eye vertically, 35 to 4 millimeters from the limbus, depending on the lens status, and inject the gas at moderate pace. Visualize the optic nerve head for the evaluation of intraocular pressure. Carefully evaluate the central retinal artery for perfusion and confirm light perception. Loss of pulsation requires decompression through an anterior chamber paracentesis. Instruct the patient on proper head positioning. Can draw an arrow in the clock hour of the retinal tear and instruct the patient to position their head so that the arrow is pointing straight up. Alternatively, can have patient's family take a picture while in the office with the proper head position, so the patient can reference this picture at home to properly position. Indications: retinal bricks located in the superior two-thirds of the fundus, from 8 to 4 o'clock. No break in the inferior 4 o'clock hours. Single or multiple breaks within 1 o'clock hour. No proliferative vitreal retinopathy, grade V or worse. Minimal media opacity. No glaucoma history. And patient able to maintain head positioning for 5 to 8 days after procedure. Remember, pneumatic retinopexy is currently underutilized. With appropriate patient selection, a high success rate can be achieved, and anatomic success rates of over 19% can be achieved when the strict selection criteria are applied. There is a low rate of postoperative complications, and intraoperative complications are primarily related to the intraocular pressure rise caused by gas injection or the misdirection of the gas. In selected cases, this procedure may present some advantages compared to the pars plana vitrectomy and scleral buckling, playing an important role in the armamentarium of the vitreoretinal surgeon.